on the role of banana leaf cuticular wax in drought tolerance, composition and regulation of its biosynthesis.
Okay, good morning everybody. What I'm going to talk about here another 30-40 minutes is one of my PhD student work. Here what we used physiology, metabolite, gene expression and some bioinformatics also. So how all the three one can integrate in a study, so you can see that, and also what are the results which help in drought tolerance. Coming to introduce the banana is a you know, all of your horticulture student, no? Yes. So it has a large leaf area and shallow root system, and because of large leaf area, it tend to transfer more of water, isn't it? So then shallow root system will not allow to take the water from the deeper soils. So it is very in the surface only. So there is always a conflict between demand and supply. So how one can get over this is, one way you can get over this, having low stomatal density. Why we need low stomatal density? To reduce the transpiration. Okay. So, and another way we can reduce the transpiration by high cuticular wax. Hope all of you know cuticular wax. Yes. So, and another one can to meet the demand, one can have more supply. How we can do that? Increase the root depth. Yeah, root mass or root depth. So these are the three strategies one can think for the banana. You have any other strategies? You should tell. Any other strategies? Huh? Yeah. Any other? Yeah, that root biomass, it will, everything is there. Length, hay, everything. So one can increase the water efficiency per unit water. You can produce more dry matter. You can select those things. Or improve the water conductivity, or some strategy you can think of, isn't it? So coming to the cuticular wax, it's a very long chain fatty acid compounds which form cuticular wax. So have you seen banana leaves and sheath? You can see white scaly things on that. Huh? It's a cuticular wax. So you know where our fatty acids are synthesized in plants? Where? It's synthesized in the plastids. Okay. So basically fatty acids are 16 to 18, generally synthesized in the plastid, and then they move to the endoplasmic reticulum, where they will become very long chain fatty acid. Don't write, you listen to me. So in the endoplasmic reticulum, the fatty acids become very long fatty acid chains. So basically wax contains very long fatty acid chains, and there are some. So you can see here, don't bother about here. So this fatty, very long, basically acetyl-CoA is the basic backbone of your fatty acid, isn't it? It may, then to increase the chain, it interact with melanyl-CoA, and you can see 16 becomes 6-18, 6-10, 2-2 carbons are added. So we have there are many enzymes are there. KCS enzymes, they are called keto acyl synthase enzymes, are involved in. For example, in cotton has a 53 genes. I don't know how many banana is there. It's there more than 30 genes are there. You know, they are numbered in KCS 10, KCS 12, depending on small changes there. Okay, don't worry about that. So then there are functional groups are added. Some ester groups are added, some alkane groups are added, some alcohol groups are added. So we know that the large quantity of wax, that is higher wax coating, is beneficial for the plants. So it is well documented in many of the drought tolerant crops like in sorghum, maize, everything. So we wanted to know, we wanted to ask some four questions, like, does cuticular wax play a role in water retention capacity in banana leaves? You know, what is water retention capacity? Anybody heard of water retention capacity? What is that? Have you done any experiments in your undergraduates or in the PG, leaf water retention capacity? See, it's a simple experiment they do. What they do, they cut the leaf, hang it on the way, hang it on the room for 24 hours, 48 hours. The rate of loss of water is measured, okay? After 24 or 48 hours, you take the weight. So whatever the genotype which can hold the, retain the water, is more tolerant. That's what they do. There's a quick screening technology used in maize and sorghum. So we did that. So whether, because that is directly related to drought tolerant capacity. Okay? See, so does cuticular play in water retention capacity? Does any, only quantity matters. If I have more wax, I am happy. Is it, or whether the composition, I told it has esters, alkanes, alcohols, and there are different carbon chain lengths also there. So whether the quality also matters. Just quantity or quality? So we wanted to ask that question. And is there any, if I find two contrasting genotypes, like resistance or tolerant or susceptible, is there any change in the composition or the change in the pattern of deposition during the development? And the fourth question we asked here, what are the genes which regulate wax synthesis in this contrasting genotype? Are there any change in the expression pattern? Are there a change in the mRNA? What are mRNA now? Yeah. What they do? They regulate the gene expression. They silence or they do anything, but they regulate the gene expression. So there are any changes in the this pattern. So that's what we wanted to do. In first experiment, we took some 15 genotypes which are having different wax content. You can see this is a milligram per centimeter square, microgram. And we measured and we have water retention capacity. There is a positive correlation between water retention capacity and wax content. More the wax content, more water retention capacity. See, after when you first you hang the leaves in the leaf in the room, so after 10 or 15 minutes, the all stomata will close. Later, the water loss is through only non-stomatal loss. That is through epidermal cells, which is having cuticular wax coating. So the more the wax, less water loss. So more water retention capacity. So then we did the GCMS analysis. We could find 71 different compounds in the banana wax, cuticular wax. So, but we classified into major groups, alcohols, aldehyde, ketones, fatty acids, esters, and others, and leaf water. We did the simple correlation study. What we could find, and also we classified into carbon length, which is less than C28, and carbon length which is greater than C28. That is, in the very long chain acid, fatty acid also, we can classify it. Longer chain, less longer chain, okay? So, less than C28 carbon and greater than C28 carbon. So, we could find positive correlation with the LWRC with the genotype which are having more amount of carbon which is more than C28 have more water retention capacity, and the alcohol, if the composition is alcohol composition more, they have more water retention capacity, and ester, if they are more, they have more water retention capacity. So do you have any doubt here? This is a long chain bed. It is like basically fiber. You can put more long chains, you have a tight fiber, so that the porosity will come down, basically. If you have small, it is difficult like this, you have it. So you have longer one, the porosity will reduce that, basically. So then these are the different enzymes which are, I told you there are like, in cotton we have 53 different genes and KCS. This is also, they are all part of KCS. And we measured the gene expression in high vax genotypes and low vax genotypes. To not surprisingly, that this is, the high vax genotypes have higher gene expression compared to low vax genotypes. So this is the one. So disease we did at the sixth leaf stage, from the top, the sixth leaf, the matured leaf. Okay. So the first experiment showed that there are totally 71 different cuticular wax compounds are there, and there is a positive correlation between leaf water retention capacity and wax content. And the classification of soluble wax, that I told you that using GCMS we classified that. There is a positive correlation between, different wax components, okay? Alcohols and ester and long, more than 28 carbon chain length. And is that, okay, positive correlation. Gene expression of KCS and FTB showed that there is total wax content in contrasting genotype is also because of high gene expression. Coming to, is there any change in the wax composition? Here we took two contrasting genotypes. Actually, there are two species that are very contrasting. You have heard of Miso acuminata and Miso bulbiciana? What is Miso bulbiciana? How many of you from Northeast? Okay, you might have seen wild bananas, no? They're long and tall. They have more wax content. They are drought tolerant. So they are wild banana. So we took two, and Miso acuminata is it's not cultivated. That is also wild. But see, Miso acuminata is called A genome, and Miso bulbiciana B genome. What we eat is what? Yeah, what we find in Cavendish is A genome. Anybody from Kerala? Yeah, so they all eat Nendran. That is AAB. And there are AB also there. Nepuvan, Elaki also there. And most of the cooking bananas, ABB. See, more the B component, it is more carbohydrates. So it won't get converted into sugar. So that goes to the cooking banana. More A component, they ripen. But Nendran, they use it for both cooking and eating also. So AAB is used both. But ABB is exclusively for cooking banana. And AAA, what we eat, the Cavendish, that is for dessert. Okay. So as I told you that when plastid fatty acids are synthesized up to C16, C18, then it moves to the endoplasmic reticulum. Then it converted into very long chain fatty acids, and then there will be bifurcation into alcohol pathway and alkane pathway. So here the we look at the this is the enzyme which are involved in elongation. Okay. So we examine this particular enzyme, CUT1 or CRC1, it is KCC6. I told you there are different forms of enzymes are there. So this one is involved in elongation from C28 to C30. This step, this particular enzyme, KCS enzyme is involved. So he wanted to see whether this particular enzyme is involved in contrasting genotypes. So if it is involved, so we should find differences in the contrasting genotype, isn't it? So what we did, we measured using GCMA. This is a standard hydrocarbon standard. So it will tell you what the C18, C, you can see here, C20, 22, 28. This is a standard carbon compound. In the Calcutta, for that is acuminate, here there is more, these are susceptible, less. Here this is B is Bihikela, that what you find in Northeast, it's a Bulbiciana, they are more tolerant. So you have more accumulation of more than C28 carbon CK. You can see here. Here is a, in this miso accumulator Calcutta, there is a most of the carbon gets accumulated in less than 28. So then we examine gene expression. Okay. First we examine the what is it? Cuticular wax. Cuticular wax with C28, less than C28. You can see Calcutta 4, which is susceptible, accumulates more of C28. First graph is C28 carbon. You can see the black one, darker one. It accumulates more of C28 carbon from this is second leaf, third leaf, fourth leaf, fifth leaf, sixth leaf. From the as the leaf develops, it keeps accumulating more of C28 carbon. So it is not able to convert C28 into long chain fatty acid. In other in contrasting genotype, Bihikela, the greener one, B, which is the graph B, you have more than C28 carbon fatty acids. Isn't it? Any doubt here? Did you understand these three graphs? This is GCMS graph. This it just tells you the Calcutta for what is the C28 carbon compared to standard. And here you can see, based on the area, you can calculate what is the amount it's accumulating in the different leaf stages. That is, this is a matured leaf, and this is the from the top is the second leaf, still growing leaf. So basically, they are the second to sixth leaf, they are different developmental stages. So there is quite different pattern in contrasting genotype, that is in the tolerant genotype, they accumulate more than C28 carbon. Okay. So then come to gene expression. The CUT1, CR1, which converts C28 into C30 and C32. So that enzyme is highly active in Bihikela. You can see here the gene expression. Any surprise? No.
Sir, why it is more expressed in fourth leaf stage? Why it is more expressed in fourth leaf stage?
Fourth is in the, it is in the, what you have a growth curve, which is that exponential growth. These are all small young leaf. These are second leaf. Fourth. Sixth is a mature leaf. It's a, why it's expressed more? The deposition is more during that time. So that it's expressed. Here also it's expressed, but it is in the, what is the exponential growth curve. The expansion occurs more in the fourth leaf stage. So that is expressed more here. Maybe the proteins are more during that time. But we need to compare here between Calcutta 4 and Bihikela. Calcutta 4 is susceptible or low wax genotype. Bihikela is high wax genotype. and it has more than C28 carbon. So we found that whatever the biochemical data is supported by gene expression study. Then we wanted to look into, these are two species and two contrasting genotypes. Are there different genes? This cut one. So what we did, we isolated a small part of the gene and did the sequencing. So this is basically phylogenetic analysis, and to see whether they are structurally different, whether they evolved different separately. So bean genome, it looks like they are all completely different compared to that A genome. So they have, that means they are structurally different. So this can be used as a marker. You are all now studying marker assisted selection and things, no? So one can use this as a marker, or one can use this as a gene of interest to overexpress in your susceptible genome. You want to increase the wax content, take this particular gene, overexpress it. Is it possible? Yes or no? You don't have doubt. Only if I take some gene and they are structurally different, if I overexpress, do I get? You need supporting other things, na? Gene is simply not that expressing, it will not help. So you need so many other, we need to have support. Where do you, that your, the substrate has to come for that particular, it's not that simple. I'm telling you that it can act as a one marker or one gene of interest. It's a candidate gene, basically. We need to check whether, anyway, people have done that in Arabidopsis. They showed that you can, overexpression will help to increase the wax content. Not in banana, but here we have identified structurally they are different, and that it can become a candidate gene. So what is the conclusion from the second experiment? You should tell now, okay? The difference between Bulbiciana, that is Bihikela, and Acuminata, Calcutta 4, at the composition level, its special reference is C28. And greater than C compound, 5 different leaf development stages we have done. 10-fold more accumulation of C28, you can see that there. And a negative relationship between C28 compound accumulation expression, isn't it? And other, okay, so structural differences also we have observed between Mesa acuminata and Bihikela by phylogenetic analysis. So, as I told you, the cut 1 or C or the KCS become a good contributor for cuticular vaccine banana. One can try that if somebody wants to increase that. Next, coming to the gene regulation. We wanted to know whether this particular gene is KCS is regulated by miRNA. So, have you heard of miRNA? Anybody has read any whole genome sequence paper recently? How many of you go to library and read journals? Tell me. As a research student, you should read whatever time you spend in field or lab, equal amount you should read. Otherwise, you won't be appreciating whatever you're doing. You're generally doing what your guide or your committee says. You should read and think, okay? How many miRNAs in banana? Or how many miRNAs in tomato? Or any crop? Anybody remembers? None of you read any whole genome sequence paper? Not interested? What do you do with your time after classes? Give me some rough idea, any crap. Okay. Okay, tell me, what is miRNA? What is mRNA, miRNA? Okay. What is antisense? Antisense RNA. This mRNA is antisense or it's or no? Okay. You know what is post transcriptional gene silencing? What is, why, what happens? Fast, I think you should all lay a 10-year old concept now. Huh? How it happens? Okay. Basically what happens, they are all antisense RNA tech. Typical the same as if the somebody knows antisense RNA, it becomes double stranded RNA. So it's not available for translation. Basically that was the thought. Then people identified DICER. So the system doesn't like double stranded RNA. Why? Huh? Why system doesn't like double stranded RNA? Why it has evolved such a system? First, because it's a basically one of the anti-viral defense mechanism. Most of the virus they multiply through double stranded DNA, RNA, RNA, RNA. Huh? That's why I told you people should go read. So these are like miRNA, siRNA, long non-coding RNA, all work on this double stranded RNA, DNA, DNA, RNA hybrid. Huh? Okay. Same way that DICER will identify those double stranded RNA or double stranded RNA, DNA and break it. Okay. What is the difference between miRNA and long non-coding RNA?
Size of the
nucleotide. Basically, yeah. Size of the link. Okay? They are more than 200 nucleotide. They are 22, 25. So, what we did, there are more than 250 to 300 miRNAs in bioinformatic analysis one can do and identify miRNA in the transcriptome. So, we have to predict. So, based on the length, homology, one can predict miRNA. We predicted, sorry for this bad slide, some 217 miRNA and 118 miRNA in Acuminata and 227. We had this transcriptome data. We predicted. And there are many things are there in homology, and also there is a minimum folding energy. In any system, higher the energy, they are. Should know chemistry also. Higher the energy, what happens? They are unstable. Okay? So your protein is unstable means it's on high energy. So if it has minimum folding energy, that means it's stable. Okay? Based on the minimum folding energy, and we could identify some miRNA. And based on homology, you can identify the targets also. Okay, I have the this is the miRNA, my sequence, and I can identify the target. What are the RNA it goes and binds and destroys. Once it binds, based on the homology, I know that that particular mRNA is going to regulate that gene. Isn't it? Any doubt? Okay. So we selected three high vax genotypes and four low vax genotypes. So we identified, as I told you, MIRNAs and from the transcriptome data, from the mesakimnet and bulbiciana, some of 41 is, some 35% are common and 55% are the specific to mesa bulbiciana and 21% mesakimnet. So they are involved in different processes, biological process, molecular function and cellular process. These MIRNA which we identified. So don't worry about this, okay? But we are interested in wax metabolic process and wax biosynthetic process. So because we are studying wax, isn't it? Then through bioinformatic process, we identified three MIRNAs, MIR531, 529. 531 can regulate KCS11, okay? And 529 can regulate KCS10, that is also called fiddlehead FDH. And this is the minimum folding energy for this. And mRNA 414 can regulate KCS3. So this is a complementary strands which identified. And this is our in silico characterization. What we need to do is, you need to validate in the wet lab, isn't it? Through what? How to validate this? Yes, I can hear RT-PCR. Loudly. RT-PCR, qPCR. Okay? So, as I told you, if they are regulating, they are going to bind this, get destroyed, and you have less wax. So I'm doing it in little different way. I'll look for the less wax and you'll go back at their expression. Okay? So this is the high wax genotypes and the low wax genotypes, and then that KCS11 and KCS3, we did the expression. You can see as expected, high wax genotypes, high expression, low wax genotypes, low expression. Okay. Depending on the folding, these are the folding, and this is the folding of those three miRNA, and this is the complementarity during their attachment. Okay, but out of three, all the three didn't work. Okay, only two worked for us. So because bioinformatic analysis doesn't work always, so there be some failure also there, but we had the good success rate, 66%. So what we did, KCS10, which is regulated by Y29 through our bioinformatic. KCS11 is regulated by 531. So this, usually when you see the expression, you have a negative relationship. Not like it won't fit into your correlation regression, but higher is lower, your this is higher, this is going to be lower. So that relationship will be there. So this is based on as expected. So in high wax genotype, we have high KCS10 FDH expression, but the MIR529 is lower in the expression. But in low wax genotype, they have this mRNA in high quantity. And thereby, you can see this one. Okay. See, you can do this experiment in another way. You can mutate this and check whether in this genotype, if you mutate KCS11, if there is a change in the expression, one can see that. That's what the people do it in the functional analysis. You know, the functional, I think some speaker might have already shown that how to do functional. How do you do functional analysis? Louder. By mutation. Another way? Yeah, any mutation. TDN insertion or... Yeah, reverse generation. Whatever reverse generation you do that. See, another way one can do is do overexpression. You just overexpress this. MIR59. Then you should see the complete suppression of KCS10. So that's another way. But we could not do in banana. This is another approach we took, that we took some 3-4 high wax genotypes and 3-4 low wax genotypes. We studied that. So our reviewer told you do functional analysis and show that it's really working that. Then we replied that. So another way, looking at the population, you take the contrasting genotype and see whether they are having a negative relationship. So that's what we did. So KCS 11, I told you, is regulated by 531 based on our bioinformatic analysis. Here qPCR also shows that same. So these high vac genotypes have lower expression of this miRNA, these both miRNA, and low vac genotypes have higher expression. So coming to that, so I generally told we have identified some conserved miRNAs in the Bulbician and Acuminata, and we identified 531, 529, which can regulate KCS11 and KCS10. And that this validates our computational prediction that these two miRNAs are involved in regulation of wax biosynthesis, isn't it? You all tired or hungry for lunch? No, or looking some exciting lunch then like this lecture. So coming to the conclusion, now our study is that it's not just not the quantity, the ester, alcohol, and longer than C28 compounds also matters in wax. And genes involved are like ACS11, FAD, FDH, CUT1, and also we identified the regulator of the two miRNA again, 531 for KCS11 and 529 for KCS10. So these two will regulate our gene expression of the wax. So this is my team. This is breeder and is our lab. And I thank funding from NPTC, MICA. Okay, you have any questions? Tired? You can't uniformly apply. You can make it. It's usually uniformly synthesized. There's no problem then. It's a cost to the plant. If you it's a penalty. Instead of growing taller, growing better yield, it has to synthesize